Thanks everybody for coming. It's pretty exciting for us to do this first Parity meetup after starting the company about a year ago, starting from zero, then building a client that saved the network during the DOSing attacks, and then recently releasing a UI that Jaco is going to demo later. And then we have a few other people speaking today. Mona is here. She'll start with an intro about a new project we are going to work on starting next year called Polkadot, a collaboration between Melonport and us. And Gavin is going to give a few more details on the tech afterwards. In terms of housekeeping, so there's a bathroom here, but maybe during the talks, go downstairs. There's one on the first floor, and doors are open just like right under this one on the first floor. Thanks to Agora for hosting us here. That's a really awesome space. Thanks to Ryan for doing the recording. Thanks to Xenia for organizing the drinks. For anybody who has beers, please reuse the glasses afterwards once you had your drink. And then, yeah, it's pretty exciting. I mean, I heard people came from even Kaliningrad here, so yeah. We're pretty proud. Welcome.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jaco. I'm representing the UI team for Parity. This is a little bit smaller than we normally view it at, so I'm hoping it works. Everything works as expected. So I don't know how many of you have played with this or seen it or maybe saw some videos or screenshots, but I'll just give a very brief overview of what we're trying to do on the UI and also where we're going, so how things look. So initially, the first time you start it up, you will see this screen. It just, you know, simple introduction screen. And we really want to focus on the guys who've never run this before. You know, so the guys who've been in the Ethereum space for a very long time, they might think, well, you know, I don't want to go through all these steps, but also think about where we're coming from. You know, we want to make the first setup as simple as possible. So next screen, and then we've got all the legal text. Okay, let me just try again on the hopefully this works. Ah, okay, that's a little bit better. Okay, so hopefully you've all read that, accepted, agreed. like I said, for us it's about focusing on the new users, and the first thing we do is actually we guide you through creating an account. So with the account, it's, you know, you can do a descriptive name for yourself. If you've got a password hint, and then just repeating your password. And then we also allow you to just select your identity icon. You know, some people are very, like these things to be very pretty. Other people don't care. Unfortunately, once you start caring, you might spend a little bit too much time going through. Let's see, I like that one. And then it creates the actual account for you. So what it does is it creates an account and it actually gives you a recovery phrase as well. So the recovery phrase is just there, and you need to keep this very secure. You know, I think the warning needs to be quite explicit. Is the recovery phrase actually allows you to recover your whole wallet. So if you give this to your friend and he installs it, uses the recovery phrase on his PC, it means he's got access to the full, the private keys, etc., etc. You know, so it's quite important that you keep this quite secure. And then next, and that's basically the setup process. As things move along, we'll probably expand on it. You know, maybe bring in some more stuff about warp syncing, etc., etc. And as you can see, there's the account I created. So on the first iteration, and when we released this in 1.4, we didn't try to do everything. We really focused on trying to build a very good wallet. You know, so for us, it's about managing the accounts. And you know, when you manage your accounts, it provides a very good starting point for where we want to get to. You know, so we want to get into the dApps and, you know, all the wonderful things that makes Ethereum great. So for us, the first focus really wasn't a wallet. So for a wallet side, we've got obviously all the accounts on your machine. You can also, you know, import accounts, so you can create either via recovery phrase from Gev key store, if you've got a backup JSON file, draw private key, pre-sale, etc., etc. And then you can also tag your accounts, so you can see I've got some accounts that are tagged. And then we've got some, you know, searching and, oops, let's go back. So those are, that's the account page. So if I click through on an account, you'll see it actually displays the balances and then all the transactions that I actually did. I'll get back to that a little bit later. Then we've got an address book. Address book, I don't know if you're like me, when specifically when you work with accounts, you always tend to send to the same group of people or to your friends or, you know, you want to monitor things that are going on out there. So the address book actually allows you to do that. So all it does is you can add an address, and when you transact at a later point in time, you can actually search for an address and you can transfer Ether or just see what they've done in terms of transactions. Once again, you know, new address, basically specify a network address, a name, and a description. Applications is where we've actually got the dApps in the system. So to start off with, we've populated it with a couple of dApps we've written. You know, some of them are just to have fun. Some of them actually add some real value to the ecosystem. And then we also allow you to add your own dApps. So if you've got local dApps that you develop locally or dApps that you deploy in a network, we can all display it on you. So if you look at my list, I've got these two dApps. The Killer Bunny dApp is actually done with a dApp generator, and that's actually just on my local machine. And then we've got the built-in dApps. So we've got one for dApp registration, we've got GitHub hint, we've got one where we actually allow you to register import ABIs, and we actually use that for lookups in our system. We've got a registry, name registry, we allow you to do some simple token deployments, we've got a token registry, and then you can actually view local transactions and transactions actually on the network. So this is quite, I think we spend quite a lot of time on this. You can actually see all the transactions in the network plus the ones you've actually sent. And then there are dApps on the network. So these are all not developed by us. You might see some of our names there, like Gavcoin is done by Gavin. You know, Parity Web3 Console, also by Gavin. I think he's quite busy writing dApps. React app, this was done over the weekend with a workshop that Thomas hosted, just about, you know, writing dApps. So as part of the workshop, one of the guys wrote this and he actually published it to the network. You know, very simple, it just shows you the blocks, the number of transactions, the last blocks and the average value. You know, so just it's simple. So basically all these dApps are, you know, they each look very different. You know, we allowed some basic customization so you can actually add and remove what you see on the page. And in the future, we'll have a lot more focus on that so you can extend it. So as you can see currently, you can already, you know, publish the app on the network and it will actually show up automatically. So this morning when I actually woke up, I saw, oh, the guys last night, they were quite busy and they published the app and I could actually play with it. You know, so that's quite nice. The contracts page. So the contracts is, you know, what we used in the Ethereum world. By default, we actually don't show that tab because I think as a developer, you know, it's quite useful to be able to interact with contracts. And I think in the end of the day, as the end user, you actually want to use a UI that just, you know, works for you on that contract. You know, you don't want to actually understand, well, these are the functions inside the contract and I actually want to call those. But if you want to go down that route, we do allow you with a UI for it. So we've got queries for all what happens in the contract. We show all the contract events. you know, this one somebody bought at that price for that amount. And then we also allow you to execute functions on the contract. You know, it's a very basic, I think, what you use typically. You know, you attach the contract, add an ABR, and off you can go. You know, so it's great for development. As an end user, we don't really see that they will end up on this page. Status just shows some basic network status, plus you can actually see your logs of your node running. Designer, I'll get to that. Settings, you know, I can customize the actual views that I've got in the application. I can customize my background. So the background will be unique to your application. I'll get back to that just now. So say I want to send a transaction, how would I go about it? Well, it's very simple. I would go to transfer, and like I said previously, I can actually search for any address in the network. So if I want to send to address in my contact list, let's send some ETH to Gavin. I'm sure he needs some. This is on a test network, sorry Gavin. And as soon as you complete a transaction, what pops up is our secure signer. So the way we've actually integrated security is that anywhere in the application where you interact with the systems, where you do a send transaction, or in our world where you do a post transaction, the secure signer will actually intercept that message. And we've got one place where you actually enter your password. So every time you send a transaction, you'll see the little mobile pop up. So this was now a normal transaction. If I'm in a dApp, this is Gavcoin. So if I buy some Gavcoin, you'll see the same thing pops up. So on the signer, I can see, well, I've posted from this account. I'm sending one ETH. I'm sending to that address. You know, and here I can actually approve or I can actually reject the transaction. If I don't want to do that, So anywhere we go, the signer sort of intercepts the message, and you know, I think on the Parity side, we've gone through great lengths to ensure that the connection between the UI. And the node is, you know, as secure as possible, running on a local network. You know, and it definitely beats you having to type in your password into random dApps along the way. You know, so for us, it's all about making sure that your accounts and your ETH are actually as secure as possible. So that's basically the long and the short of what we're trying to do. I think where we're definitely going next, and with 1.5 you see a lot of those things, is we're trying to make the signer infrastructure much smoother. You know, so we're bringing in things like you can actually limit the accounts that a certain dApp has got access to. You know, we're bringing in the multi-sig wallets, which I think we ran out of time for 1.4. You know, if we had a couple more weeks, we would have had it in. You know, and we'll treat those as sort of first-class citizens in our world. For 1.6 and going forward is really focusing on the developer tools. You know, extending it, making it easy, allowing you to actually see when you interact with contracts, exactly what happened, how the state changed. Which I think as a developer is quite important, because a lot of times, you know, in this world is you develop, something goes wrong or something goes right and you're not quite sure exactly what happened. So a big focus on that is for us is on that. And in addition to that, it's actually making the distributed app interfaces much smoother. You know, I think we've got the start of having it integrated. And where we want to go next is to actually make it as simple as possible, so you can actually deploy applications on the network. I think Gavin, when he originally The reason why I'm doing the presentation is because Gavin wanted to go all cowboy and show how easy it is to deploy an application. it's actually quite easy, but it's not as simple as it should be. Any specific questions, comments? No, you work for us.
Yep.
No, you're not allowed to. You should know these.
Okay, maybe you can tell us a little bit about why the background makes it more secure.
Okay. So when the actual UI connects to the signer, it runs in a completely different environment than your dApps would run in. You know, so we've split the two, so the dApps run in one sandbox and our UI, which we hopefully is trusted, runs in a different sandbox. The trick you've got, however, is when you're in any application, so if I'm in this application and this application sends a transaction, you know, it's very easy for anybody to go and build something, because in the end of the day, it's just HTML, JavaScript, build something that looks exactly the same as our UI. So what we've tried to do is saying, yes, okay, so we got the connection secure between the front end and the back end, but at the same point in time, we want the user to A, customize his environment, and in an environment, he can be sure that actually whatever pops up this little dialog box is actually his signer. So the backgrounds are randomly generated. It's specific to the actual instance, to this browser instance. So anytime anything asks you for your password, you can actually visually see that it actually belongs to you. You know, so hopefully no two instances ever looks exactly the same. You know, so that's what we try to build in a little bit of additional layer of security, so you can actually be sure that, you know, this is my application, I'm putting in my password, you know.
Yeah, maybe is it okay if we move questions to these as we first go through these? Yeah?
Yeah. More questions.
Cool. Thanks. Thanks, Jacob. Raul would usually be here. He's in Argentina right now. Hi, Raul. He's watching. And there's a bunch more people in London as well and in Russia. Cool. So we have Mona. She'll give an introduction to Polkadot, so a network we are going to work on in the next couple of years, I guess. So she started her career at Goldman and then did a few other things that she can maybe speak about herself if she wants to. Before she then got into blockchain and started a company called Melonport together with Rito. They are based out of Switzerland. Cool.
Thanks.
I can sort you out. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Can you help me change the slides?
Does anybody have, by chance, a presenter for clicking or anything? Otherwise, I do it manually.
Thanks. Okay, hi guys. So my name is Mona. I'm probably the only one in here who doesn't have a proper full technical background, but I started my career actually in finance. I was a market maker and trader at Goldman Sachs for about 8 years, and then I moved to the fund management side, where I looked after a long short equity portfolio. And then about a year and a bit ago, I decided to take some time off and learn about blockchain, which is what brought me to my now business partner, Rito Trinkler, who was trying to build an asset management tool on Ethereum, or software and protocol for asset management, completely decentralized. And you know, basically there were so many parallels to what I was doing before and what he was building, and I could see so many efficiencies that he could extract that one thing led to another, and now we're sort of working full-time on Melonport. And a few months ago, we started to realize we had this pretty big challenge. And the challenge was, you know, we're already building the smart contracts on Ethereum, and everything was starting to look good, but we started to visualize the future. And we started to hear about other blockchains being built, and we knew about some private consortium blockchains that were being built. We heard about, you know, certain zero-knowledge proof chains, and we started to imagine a world where maybe there's not one winning chain, so to say, but maybe a world of many different types of blockchain which all serve their own purpose and all have their own properties. So we started to think, God, what are we going to do with Melon, and how are we going to make it be able to interact with other assets that might exist on other chains in a decentralized way if we're going to stick to our goals? And we decided to park the issue aside for a moment and think, well, there must be somebody working on this issue who's going to solve it. Let's just focus on what we're doing and then let someone else solve it and then kind of work with whatever the solution is. Little did we know that it was actually going to be Gavin Wood, who was already our advisor, who was already working on a solution called Polkadot, which was very complementary to what we were building. And that brought us to the Polkadot paper, which was published a couple of weeks ago or so. I've just described a bit about the relationship. Everybody here probably has heard of the Polkadot paper by now, which describes a solution for a heterogeneous multi-chain solution, or I like to think about it in my kind of non-technical way as the internet of blockchains. And so we basically decided that we wanted to be a part of this and we wanted to use Polkadot for Melon. And basically we decided to form a collaboration with Parity in order to do so. So I'm going to kind of start with my overview on Polkadot, and then since Gavin's here, I'm going to let him do a little bit of a deep dive into it. The way I look at kind of the evolution of the blockchain space is I see blockchain kind of introduced to us the idea of blockchain accounting, the idea that someone can make a transfer in a trustless way to someone without having a central party, without having to know them. And then we had Ethereum, which introduced to us the idea of the blockchain computer and the idea of adding a layer of logic on that. And I guess over the last few months or even couple of years, we've seen some ideas or some different iterations evolve on the Ethereum idea, which brings us to the problem that we were trying to solve, which is, you know, how do we make all of these blockchains communicate with each other in a trustless way? And that's what I see Polkadot. I think about Polkadot as the blockchain internet or the internet of blockchains. So I'm going to give a little bit of, maybe start with a bit of a definition. So Polkadot is the blockchain network responsible for relaying authenticated transactions from one chain to another. And the idea is that parachains can plug into the Polkadot network. In order to be, so you can think about parachains as extensible elements, and the only condition for a new parachain is that it's a validatable, globally coherent data structure. I guess we've kind of touched on some of the motivations. So we've seen many chains arising in the space. Each chain is kind of isolated within its chain. The only way currently for chains to interact with each other is this idea of centralized exchanges, which is probably not a solution that suits everyone. Each chain has its own differentiating properties. So in our world, at least, we recognize that every chain has a use case, maybe, or people who are building on a certain chain are doing it because it meets their properties. And the question of how do we integrate them all together is Polkadot. Or the answer to that question is Polkadot. So I like to think of it as a blockchain internet membership. Polkadot ensures that new chains have the option of joining into this communication world and allows trustless transactions between these member chains with pooled security. So I guess there's two kind of connectable chains we have to think about here. One is a parachain. These are kind of chains that haven't necessarily been deployed yet. And I guess they can have similar properties to legacy chains, but instead of providing a proof of work, they have to provide a proof of validity and then outsource the consensus and networking to Polkadot. Polkadot stakeholders get to vote or play stakeholder to add, modify, or remove chains within the network. And if you're a parachain, you basically don't have any intrinsic cost to join the network. So it's really kind of, it can be as easy as a plug and play. Then the question is, you know, what if you're working with a chain that's already been deployed or a legacy chain? So this is a bit more challenging, but interestingly, as the paper goes on about, is not impossible. Definitely needs some requirements to build additional infrastructure. Probably can keep their consensus mechanisms, and I'm sure Gavin might go into a bit more detail about that later. And Polkadot stakeholders get to add, modify, or remove according to their stake. So that's another very interesting property. In theory, Polkadot can be open to all kinds of chains. This is just a few interesting snippets I took out of the paper because I found this quite interesting myself. I like the kind of design rules of Polkadot. Gavin's proposal uses these, it runs by these kind of four rules, and I thought they were worth highlighting. The idea of Polkadot is to be minimal with as little functionality as possible. Keep it simple, so don't try to add layers of complexity or too many smart contracts or any other things. Leave that to the parachain. General, no unnecessary requirements than what's necessary, and robust, so keep it simple and aim to make it secure. And the idea of Polkadot is that it has within it an intrinsic network token, which will be called the DOT token. This exists out of a necessity for the consensus proof of stake process. And basically, it allows you to perform the validator role. So basically participating in the consensus mechanism. Allows you a voting stake. So we've mentioned this a couple of times to add, modify, and remove member parachains. And also rewards validators who bond their collateral or bond their DOT tokens in order to perform the validator function. And finally, having DOT tokens gives you a role in the governance process of the overall network. So actually, I'm going to hand over to Gavin now. Where's Gavin?
Yes, so that was the basic introduction about what we're aiming to achieve with Polkadot. So I want to tell you a little more about like how it works. So the first thing to try and understand is like, what actually is it? What are we trying to build? How is it? You know, we need to understand these properties in order to figure out how it's different to what's already been before. So there are three critical properties that I'm going to identify with Polkadot that I think are reasonably novel, at least in this space. So the first is this notion of extensibility, or you might call it upgradability, modularity. Polkadot is designed to be a system that has many very much different designed parts that are able to come into it at later stages. So as we discover more interesting, more performant, more effective means of forming consensus and achieving the sorts of solutions that we actually want blockchain to deliver, these kinds of technologies should be able to be brought into the Polkadot protocol as first-class citizens. The second is scalability. Scalability has been a problem dogging blockchain since day one. And Polkadot aims to make some significant advances in this. Now, I wouldn't want to say that Polkadot is some sort of, you know, game, end game for scalability. I don't think it is, but it could provide a path for scalability over the next at least 5 to 10 years, just through managing this initial idea of parallelizing transactions across the network. So we can actually run many different chains in parallel. And that's kind of where the name parachains comes from, these parallelized chains. The third thing is the notion of heterogeneity. So similar, you know, there are one or two other sort of proposals in this space that kind of say, well, let's, yeah, multiple chains is a great idea. We should have multiple chains. You know, we talk about sharding. What's going on? Can you keep doing that every minute? we talk about sharding, but typically these shards are very much homogeneous shards. They split the database or whatever it is, the problem space, up into several bits, but those are very much equal bits. They're cut from the same cloth. With Polkadot, it's different. The idea is that the different things that are running sort of individually and in parallel are able to be fundamentally different beasts, right? So we can actually have some chains that maybe look a bit like Bitcoin, some chains that maybe look a bit like Zcash, some chains that look like Ethereum, some chains that look like a weird Ethereum with like WebAssembly, some chains that are like crazy and all encrypted, some chains that haven't been invented yet because, you know, we don't know how we're going to want to move consensus architectures on into the future. So the idea is that they don't have to be the same kind of thing. Licorice all sorts. So fundamentally, what does Polkadot attempt to provide? What services does Polkadot want to provide to the world? Well, critically, there are two things that it provides to its constituents, to its users. The first is pool security, and the second is trust-free transaction relaying. So basically, when you join the Polkadot community, when you implement a parachain, which is under the Polkadot protocol, you get two things for free. You get the notion that whatever your parachain decides is what is valid, well, you get that for free. It will check to make sure that anything that goes on your parachain is definitely valid. It definitely follows those rules. So the rules of Bitcoin, actually Bitcoin has a relatively basic scripting language, but the rules of Bitcoin more or less form around the idea of removing or reducing value and increasing value to the equal and opposite amount. With Ethereum, it's a little different, and the rules follow a much more Turing complete scripting language. But nonetheless, there are specific rules, and this basically makes up the consensus protocol. What Polkadot allows is for these rules to be entirely arbitrary and to be decided at a later time, and different rules for different parts of the Polkadot system for these different parachains. So that's the security. The security guarantees those rules, and it's equal for everybody, equal for all members. It doesn't matter which chain you're on, they will all be equally secure. The other one is trust-free transactions. So this is very important. If chains are to be, you know, in any way interactive, this is going to be actually parallelizing rather than just have many different isolated chains where everyone has to go through some sort of exchange or some trusted intermediary in order to actually interact between them, then it's kind of useless. So trust-free transactions or trust-free interactions are critically important. And that's one thing that Polkadot, that's the other thing that Polkadot provides. So how does it work? Well, the two basic constituents of Polkadot, the relay chain and parachains, okay? So the relay chain pretty much does what you'd expect it to do. It looks after relaying transactions. It kind of sits, it connects to all of the parachains, and it shuffles transactions around between them. The other thing it does is it facilitates the finalization of transactions. So this is absolutely critical. The two move hand in hand. You can't shuffle a message from a transaction onto another parachain unless you know that the transaction from which that message is coming is definitely final. Because if it's not definitely final, then you may have to revert the message, and basically you end up with this horrible dependency graph flowing out into the entire ecosystem that you have to revert. That's no good. So rather than do that, we do it the very easy way and we say, right, well, what we'll do is tie the finality together. And we do it in the loosest way possible by introducing this, what we would call validation function that each chain can have different. Okay, so the parachains are effectively governed by these validation functions, but their finality is determined by the relay chain. So they give up the sovereignty of determining their own finality, which is a relatively minor sovereignty, for the increased ability to be able to communicate with all the other blockchains in the in this ecosystem, in the community. They still retain the sovereignty of determining their own validity, okay? And validity is the very important thing here. Finality is largely irrelevant. We don't really care. If there are two equally valid transactions to pay out, but they're equal, but they're mutually exclusive, we don't really care which one goes through as long as one of them does and only one of them. And that's what finality guarantees. Okay, so the basics of the relay chain. When designing all of this, you know, as Mona touched on earlier, I really wanted to keep things as simple as possible. So this is meant to be a solution which is in some sense scalable, extensible, and one of the ways of ensuring that we can actually get to where we want to go as soon as possible, and you know, actually develop it, is to minimize the complexity of the added features. So the relay chain really does have no functionality, right? It's there in order to do its job, which is shuffling transactions around and ensuring that there's finalization and validity. In particular, it has no way of receiving external transactions over and above those necessary to do its initial duties. And it doesn't host smart contracts. It's not like another chain, right? It's not like another Ethereum or another Bitcoin or anything like that. It doesn't fulfill any of those purposes. It fulfills some very particular purposes that up until now blockchains do not fulfill. Fees are levied to the parachains for managing those bits of things like voting, like moving funds around, since staking tokens on the main chain. So fees are levied for those basic things, but that said, it's unlikely that parachains will be doing that very often. So how is the relay chain governed? And this is in some sense the governance of Polkadot. So Polkadot, you know, aims to bring about a few things. Obviously there's those extensibility and scalability and that kind of thing. But there's also, you know, we want to really make a step towards governance. I think governance is actually a very important and largely undervalued aspect of blockchain. Largely because the first blockchain was Bitcoin, and Bitcoin is a currency. And as we know, you know, currencies, well, the governance of currencies is a bit of a touchy subject. But basically, currencies aren't companies, right? Companies have governance. Companies have a board, and they can issue shares, and they can make decisions on, you know, what direction they want their company to go in. They can deploy resources and so forth. Currencies, now you could argue, well, a currency is kind of, you know, governed. It's governed by the government of the country, and it's got the rest of the country to. But that's not really how it works, at least not in the sense of the more traditionalist Bitcoin economics, which state that actually a currency really doesn't have any resources. A currency should just be basically a physical asset that we can exchange. Now, since Polkadot has nothing to do with currencies, that argument is irrelevant for Polkadot. So actually, it's very important to bring in a governance structure to ensure that the chain itself does indeed move in a direction that we want it to go in. And any of the resources that we could say the chain actually manages should also similarly move in that direction. So there's no real decisions made on what particular governance structure there is, but it's very likely to take some kind of, you know, bicameral kind of a mechanism that we actually see more or less delivers some kind of stability in the real world. Ultimately, of course, it will be the stakeholders that can determine the direction at the end of the day. Okay, so this is a slightly complicated diagram on. You know, just to give you some idea about what's involved in Polkadot. So the idea is extensible, scalable, and flexible. So here is the relay chain. Okay, I've drawn it with seven sides, a kind of interesting figure, I always thought. And each side represents a parachain. Now, these guys, these triangles with checkered pattern in them, they're validators, okay? What they do is they police the chain, they police the system. They get deployed very often to different parachains, different parts of the system, and they get deployed to check, to make sure that everything's okay. If they make sure everything's okay, they say, hey, everything's okay here, and they sign for it. So they basically form a witness statement. They say, this bit is fine at the moment. These transactions are all valid. Yeah, that's what they do, they're validators. Up here, we have a couple of types. Now, these guys don't move around the system. They have a particular color. A color is to identify a parachain. Now, you have got two kinds of people up here. You've got collators and you've got fishermen, okay? So collators are the people who actually maintain the parachain, right? They scuttle around looking for transactions and they collate them together into a block and they provide a proof of validity for that block. So what they do is they say, I've executed this block and here's the results and I'm gonna get together all of the various bits of paperwork to be able to demonstrate to you, who is a relatively disinterested bystander who has, you know, no real knowledge of this parachain. They might know about the relay chain, but they have no knowledge of parachain. And they, from this, purely this information, will be able to say, yes, these transactions are valid and they have been executed correctly. Okay, so that's what we mean by proof of validity, yeah? So it's not about proof of work. We're not about, you know, wasting a load of energy in order to demonstrate that we've wasted a load of energy. No, that's not what we're doing. What we're doing is we're proving that we have executed transactions correctly, okay? So that's what these guys do. Fishermen are out there just to basically, hey, if there's anything bad going on, we're going to discover it, and we get a nice fat reward if we do. So the idea of fishermen is basically, you know, they got the rods out, hooks with the whatever in the water, and they're waiting for that big catch, right? Now, if any of you are amateur anglers, you probably know that you don't get the big catch very often, and hence the name is from that. Okay. Now, there's an extra thing on here, which is the parachain bridge. Now, the idea is that actually there's nothing fundamental stopping a parachain being just a stub, right? So it actually pretends to be a parachain. It says, oh, yeah, sure, we got transactions coming from here, and you can give us messages in, yeah, no problem, yeah. You can validate it, sure, yeah. But actually, it's not a full-on parachain. It's actually just pretending to be a parachain. But on the other side of the interface, right, on the other side of the relay chain, there's actually a whole other network. Yeah, and what the validation function is doing is it's checking that this block, the block from this network, is actually valid. Now, the big issue with these bridges is that they don't share finality, so they don't share the consensus mechanism, which means if this comes to a decision that actually, yes, this block is valid and the transaction's gone in and that's the one that's canonical, that's the one that will not be rolled back, that is absolutely final, then we have an issue. If on the other side of the bridge, they say, actually, no, turns out that wasn't final. We're going to revert that and we're going to go in some other direction. Hence the double spend run problem, right? Well, the basic solution to this, which I'll probably go into later or maybe not, is you wait a few blocks. I mean, this is what exchanges do, right? You wait 1,000 blocks, and if it looks like it's not being reverted, then it's probably fine. You wait an hour or you wait a day or whatever, you know, it's, and that's basically how you allow external side effects to actually go ahead with any kind of security. Okay, so who maintains it? As I've discussed, validators, collators, fishermen. Now there's also these guys called nominators, right? What nominators do is they're kind of like validators. They're kind of like validators except they're lazy, right? They can't be bothered to actually validate transactions. So what they do is they say, well, this validator and that validator, they're kind of cool guys. I know them, I've chatted to them on Reddit, maybe I've met them at a conference. Yeah, they're cool. I will, you know, fund their validation. I will put my my staking tokens in with them. They, I reckon, are sound. So these guys work through, basically they join in the party, but they do so in a relatively passive position. Collators gather these transactions floating around the network of the parachain, gather them up into a proof of validity candidate block, and fishermen monitor the network. Okay, so what's these? What's going on here? More or less what I just described. The other thing to point out is that we've got network messages being sent. These are posted transactions or messages going between parachains. We have this idea of a second order relay chain. So this would be, still a little more in the research side than the other bits of the protocol. But the idea is that this could look very much like this relay chain, except it's composed as a second order thing. So it looks like a parachain to this guy, but in fact, it actually works like a relay chain. It's got its own little parachains on the outside. And this is basically the second generation idea for scalability. So why do these guys bother doing what they're doing? Well, the basic idea here is that validators and nominators, I think as Mona touched on at the end of her presentation, these guys get paid a reward for doing what they're doing, for doing it well, and for not actually cheating. Collators are basically incentivized by whatever means the parachain that they're working on will incentivize them for. But the basic idea is they probably collect transaction fees. Fishermen are there, you know, like the big catch, it's always coming, right? These guys are basically given a proportion of the bond of whichever validator they manage to take to the tribunal and win over and demonstrate that they were behaving badly. Okay, so forming consensus, how do we do it? Well, it's basically a proof of stake system on the relay chain. It's a slightly different proof of stake system. It's a structured state machine, which basically means that we're doing several, coming to several BFT consensus over in parallel. So basically the idea is that as the state machine progresses, we obviously converge on a particular solution, but the solution is rather than just being one particular block from many valid candidates, the validity of the candidates happens over multiple dimensions. So each parachain basically is a dimension, and those get determined by virtue of the availability and the validity of what it is that they're actually meant to be processing on the parachain that all of the validators vote upon. And as they vote upon it, there are very particular rules detailed in the Polkadot paper as to how those votes turn into an ultimate consensus. The important thing is that the validation happens in parallel, and for a large part, the consensus-forming canonicalization happens in parallel, and it's only at the very end do all of them actually come together and sign off on the final amalgam of the parachain state transitions. Okay. So validators and nominators, there's an approval voting system for nominators and validators. These guys basically are form of the same set, right? So each of them can say, basically, I will be a validator. I will happily vote for myself. Nominators can say, they can also say, these are the guys, I will vote for them. Now, if you're to be part of this group, you must put in some staking tokens, right? You bond yourself into this group. To remove yourself from this group, it's very difficult. Basically, you have to wait 3 months because 3 months is roughly the kind of time span that you could still do malicious actions on the network after actually ceasing. And this boils down to the short and long range attacks that, you know, those of you who have looked into proof of stake probably have some idea about. Now the approval voting is basically, if I don't know if you know about approval voting, but basically it's like you don't have to vote for a single person, you can vote for as many as you want. And it's up to some constraint optimizer, so up to some up to some other system to work out which is the best way of fitting everything together so that everyone is effectively voting for one for someone else that they actually approve of. Yeah. So voting systems in like, you know, proper political voting systems in real countries actually have the they kind of you know, they manage this, and they actually have some particular fairly prehistoric constraint optimizers in order to ensure that the person who comes to power has in fact got, you know, in some sense the most votes. Now the idea here is that there are adaptive rewards. So the rewards paid to these validators and nominators is not specific, right? So it's not that there's some particular, like, you know, 5% or X tokens per year or anything like that. No. What we do is we say, right, well, actually, we want at least, let's suppose, 50% of all of the capital in the system, of the staking capital, that is, to be utilized, to be actually bonded, right? So you actually, we set a target for what we want to be bonded. This target basically reflects the security guarantees of the system, since it's this target which could in principle be removed from the validators for misbehavior in case they do something nasty, like get together and vote for something that is clearly invalid, that would, you know, give themselves loads of money or remove money from somewhere else or whatever it happens to be. So anything that can be done in the, you know, anything that can be broken in this way needs to be paid for by this by these bonds. And so by setting a target for what bonds we wish to reach, and increasing or decreasing inflation through a market mechanism, basically from the approval voting and constraint optimizer working together, we can ensure that we have the desired level of security. Now, what is the desired level of security? How do we quantify it? Well, that's really difficult. Research can take us so far, modeling and so forth, but ultimately we're probably going to have to keep it as a dynamic system that's whose governance mechanism actually you know, works out what happens to be the real world values that make it work in practicality. Because at the moment we don't really know, because it's new stuff, right? Okay, so validating parachains. Basically, what happens here is the collators, you know, these guys are very specific to the parachains, right? So validators are not specific to parachains. They float around, they get told which parachain to validate at a time. Most of them will actually be moving around different parachains, randomly assigned, changing every block or 10 blocks or 16 blocks or something. But they change a lot, okay? With collators, they stick to the same parachain. They need to, because they need to provide this proof of validity. And the only way we can provide a proof of validity is if you have all of the information available to you. So in our sort of fairly legacy blockchain terminology, we'd say these are full nodes. These are full nodes, and they sit on the parachain. Validators, in similar legacy terminology, they don't have any synchronization with any parachain, but they are a sort of light client, right? So what they can do is they can take these proof of validity blocks and they can verify that they're correct by virtue of having a light client. And it's this light client, or at least the mechanisms that light clients would normally have, that are built into the validation function, which is part of the relay chain, yeah? So as part of adding a parachain, you add a validation function, which is kind of like a light client for the parachain that allows the validators to take the proof of validity block candidate and say, yes, this is valid, or no, it's invalid, and throw it out. Okay, so collators go around, they scuttle around collecting transactions, build them into a block, create a proof of validity for the block, and then send it off to the validator as their sort of, their effort, right? That's it, here's my ticket, there you go. See if it's gonna win. Now, if it wins, it would go in, and any of the transaction fees that they've managed to create themselves from collating that block would become paid to them, because the block would become canonical, it would become finalized. Now, availability and validity are very important parts of the parachain validation, because what these two properties are what allow a parachain block to become canonical. So for a parachain block to become a canonical, It has to have the transactions have to be available to any of the validators whose job it is to ensure that these transactions, this data is available. Transaction data availability, and particularly external data availability, is very, very important, because if you cannot, if this data, if a block ends up getting finalized whose data is not available, then nobody can verify it in the future, right? And it could just be nonsense data, and actually the state transition that the block actually does is entirely invalid, because the input that's given is nonsense. So it's very important that we actually have this data available, and it's up to the validators, very particular validators, to say it's available, which they do as part of the consensus mechanism, and it's up to collators to, if they can't find this data, they need to report it to the validators. Now, these collators will do that, because if they don't do that, they won't be able to continue syncing their parachain. And they, since the only way that they can get transaction fees is through syncing the parachain, they're going to want to do it. In much the same way that miners, if data available for a transaction on a legacy blockchain like Bitcoin or Ethereum, if a miner produces a solution but doesn't include the transactions as part of the block, it will be rejected, not only because the software would reject it, but also because actually if I don't have those transactions, then there's no way how I could actually change the state to what it's meant to be so that I can build a new block on top of your block. Yeah. Okay, so, right, so now the hard bit, relaying transactions. So, with relaying transactions, basically the idea here is that we want to take transactions coming out of one parachain and ensure that they actually reach their destination, okay? So, there are two critical bits to relaying transactions. The first bit is you want to ensure that that whoever is organizing the relaying of transactions behaves correctly, you know, behaves accurately. What you don't want to do is to have them drop transactions arbitrarily or introduce their own transactions. If I can introduce a transaction that says, well, it's going from the Bank of England chain and it says it's transferring me $1 million, £1 million, and I introduce that to the special WebAssembly version of Ethereum chain, that would be a very bad thing to happen, because the destination chain would believe an event actually happened in a source chain without it actually happening. So it's very, very important. You know, it's whole part of the whole sort of trust-free transaction interaction, chain interaction stuff, that transactions are not dropped, nor are they included, nor are new ones included. So part of that is basically by managed by trees and proofs. Okay, so Merkle trees allow us to say that some particular leaf X is part of the tree if you believe the root is this. And what we do basically is we say that validators have to agree on the root. Yeah, and if they agree on a root which is invalid, then we can prove that it's invalid, because we can prove that, well, the inputs were these roots and the outputs were these roots, and you guys voted that these inputs equaled the plus a block transition equaled these outputs. And look, I can provide the data for the inputs and the data for the outputs, and they don't match. There's an extra one, or there's one less, or whatever. So basically, it's your classic kind of state transition, except it's a state transition that happens with, in some sense, full knowledge of all of the different parachains at a particular point in the consensus process. Now that's the first thing. It doesn't get us all the way there. What it does is it says that we can punish any validators that agree on some eventual delivery that is not a, that is invalid, a delivery of transactions that is invalid. But what it doesn't do is it doesn't actually deliver the data itself. So we also have to manage the data's logistics, yeah? So we have to get the data from one parachain that wants to send messages. We have to get the message data itself over to the other parachain that it's meant to be bound for. For that, we do a basic kind of, we have a network protocol that ensures that that the destination validators for the next block can connect to the source validators for the previous block and actually arrange the transfer, with the idea being that the consensus mechanism will only go from first block to the second block if the destination validators agree that they have all the information that they need to actually enact those incoming messages. So ensuring availability. Now this is a thorny, this is probably the hardest problem actually for these kinds of systems where you're splitting data up between many individual validators, many individual stakeholders, many individual actors. Ensuring availability is really, really hard because if you enforce everybody to have all data, it doesn't scale. And if you just place the data in separate hands all around the system, it's really hard to know if any of them are behaving maliciously and actually don't have the data at all, which means you would not be able to reproduce it, or it could actually be invalid in the first place. So it's really hard to solve this problem. And basically what we do is we rely on collators. So collators are basically public, right? Validators, there are relatively few of them and they have to be very heavily bonded. So there are, you know, maybe 150 validators. Maybe more as the system gets more and more parachains, but basically 150 validators to begin with. With collators, there can be loads and loads and loads of collators, right? Because they don't have to interact with each other. They only, they'll send transactions to each other, but basically it's all gossip. It scales relatively well. But what you can't do, we don't want to bond collators, right? So collators need to be able to, need for whatever reasons of their own, to be able to police the availability of data on their parachain, okay? So how do we do this, and why are we able to count on them for being that police if we're not paying them so much? Well, the idea is that the validators actually sign off on saying that, you know, some particular bit of data is available. So every block, the validators are assigned to a particular parachain, and the parachain maybe has some incoming transactions, so some external data that's very important for the actual block of the parachain to be computed. These could be like classic, you know, transactions in Bitcoin or Ethereum, but there might be other kinds of external data that we haven't really thought about yet that could be included in this. Now this data is really important for it to be available because it's the blockchains are deterministic, right? Which means you need all of the inputs if you're able to actually process it into all of the outputs. And this is inputs. So validators say, I agree that I will make this data available, yeah? But unfortunately, it's not all the validators, because if it were all the validators, it wouldn't scale very well, because we'd have to actually give all the validators all of the data all the time. So it's a few validators. But what we can do is we can say, right, well, this is only a few validators, but we have loads of collators for this block. And the collators should be able to get data. And we can identify collators because we can see if there have been any blocks that have been signed with their address in the past, let's say, 10,000 blocks of the parachain. Yeah, so we can very clearly identify this exclusive set of collators. And if a collator from this set, this is how we get around the whole Sybil problem. If a collator from this set says, I can't get this information, which means I can't sync this chain, we can identify them and we can say, right, well, you know, you're not just a nobody, you're a collator, you're a legitimate collator. We will look into this. So they get given a particular validator of every block that they can complain to. And that validator is bound to check and see if they can get the data from the other validator that promised to make it available. If they can't get the data, then they can initiate an entire sort of tribunal, and ultimately the validator can have its bond struck, or maybe just rewards reduced if it can't provide the data. So if it ultimately provides the data, then you know, you never know whether it's really just a network connection issue or whether it's really a nasty validator. So all you can really do is reduce the bonds. But you can be sure that the same validator, if they keep playing this trick, they're going to get their bonds reduced substantially more. So we can increase the bond reduction every time there's a complaint made, assuming the complaints are coming from different parts of the system, which they should be because the assigned validator would be a different validator each time. That's the mild punishment as opposed to the sort of massive punishment, which would be for never being able to provide the data at all. Like they forgot it or they never had it in the first place, and that would be an entire bond removal, and that's a very big event. Okay, that's mostly done that. Now, yes, so this leaves one further thing, which is, well, what if you can control the collator set? Well, then if you can control the collator set, you would never challenge a validator that you're in cahoots with, that you're working with, right? So the critical thing here is to ensure that at least there's a few collators out of the last 10,000 blocks who are acting benevolently and actually want to find the data and will complain if the data's not there. So what we do here is we introduce a notion of a golden ticket. So every block is a golden ticket for each parachain. The golden ticket is actually just an address, right? It's a simple Polkadot address. Every collator has their Polkadot address. And with this address basically denotes which collator will be treated above all others to be given a reward. So when validators come with their candidate blocks that have been fed to them from collators that they've checked and work out they're actually valid, the one who provides the block that has the closest address signed by a collator to the magic ticket, they win. Okay, and they get a little bit more reward, and maybe that reward's shared with the collator. Who knows? I mean, I'm not too bothered about that bit. But the important thing is that there's an incentivization to ensure that validators actually prefer collators with an address close to this magic ticket. Now, when we get this, what we do is we end up with something that approaches a proof of work system, except without the horrible waste of power. Because instead of that, we've actually got bandwidth. Every time a collator provides a block, of course, they have to provide quite a lot of proof of validity with it, which is a substantial bandwidth, which prevents or at least reduces a Sybil attack of someone actually hosting, 1,000 nodes all trying to wash away any of the good guys. Now, on top of that, the nice thing about the golden ticket mechanism. So the collators are providing important information into the validation system, which will be a critical part of the consensus mechanism. So if I go into the next slide, what I want to show you is that the collators themselves don't always necessarily need to be part of the underlying Polkadot framework. They don't always need to work in this particular way. In principle, all of the mechanisms I've explained to you so far are about open parachains and ensuring the security of open parachains. But in principle, there can be such things as closed parachains. So closed parachains are basically the idea that we work within the mechanism for the overarching finalization and consensus mechanism, but we ignore the validity, or at least what we don't do is we don't execute the transactions as part of the validation function. Rather, what we do is we say, well, the validation function still validates the things, but what we consider as a proof of validity is no longer executing the transactions and ensuring that they actually end up at the result that we expect, but rather is that they've been signed off by some particular set of authorities, perhaps stakeholders on some other chain, or perhaps named authorities as part of a consortium or whatever. Now, if we introduce this mechanism as a validation function, it gives us some interesting additional avenues to go down. Because if we only check that transaction signatories are valid, we can encrypt the contents of the state, because we no longer need to know the state, right? We no longer need to execute the transactions, and therefore we no longer need to know all about the state. We no longer need to know the inputs or the outputs. All we really need to know is have the proper authorities signed off on it, and secondly, has the are the messages being delivered? And if we can assume those, then all is well. So that's the closed parachains, and what that does is basically says, well, it is possible to include those sorts of things, you know, these consortium and private chains, internal chains, we can start actually thinking about including these into the community and making them be able to interact with public and open chains. And what this does is it allows services, trustless services, to get onto the public and open chains that would otherwise not be able to, not be possible. Okay. Finally, there's the bridge chains. Now, bridge chains kind of do almost the opposite. And I explained a little bit about them earlier, but the basic idea is that they keep the validation portion. So you actually do check the transactions, you ensure that everything's working properly, you've got a proof of validity block, but you ignore all of the canonicalization stuff, right? So it's like it's the opposite diagonal of the matrix. Bridges would work for things like other chains that probably legacy chains, so chains that already exist, in order to actually bring them into the community and allow them to interoperate with all the other parachains. But in principle, could also be very useful for extensible parachains that where maybe we don't have enough freedom within the standard parachain validity function architecture. And we actually want some additional freedoms that could be, in terms of technical development, that could be only taken if they're actually allowed their own canonicalization mechanism. And that's where bridges would come in handy. Right, that's been a bit of a whirlwind tour. But those are the basic points. Now, there's I didn't go into much detail, I'm afraid. There's a lot more detail in the... There's a lot more detail in the paper, and even then, it's still not all the detail that we really need. So, this is inevitably going to be a bit of a, an interesting journey, a bit of a research project. But it's a nonetheless one with very good grounds for thinking that we're going to end up with something that's worthwhile building at the end of it. I guess I can take some questions, but let's keep it just to like 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or whatever, and I'll take any further ones after on a more one-to-one basis. Yep.
Just one question about hard fork, like DAO hard fork. How does it work in this situation? If some parachain forks like DAO.
Okay, So fundamentally, parachains have a validity function, right? So the validity function states what is a valid state transition. Now, for the DAO hard fork, there was a what would generally be considered an invalid state transition. It certainly wasn't in the yellow paper. Technically, the yellow paper doesn't have any kind of official status, so that's kind of... it's arguable as to what actually counts as a valid state transition, but nonetheless, it forms a very specific shelling point. So it was outside of that, obviously. What would happen basically is it would be. I'll make sure I get this right. It would be impossible for the parachain to do that if it were not intrinsically built into some sub-governance mechanism of the parachain itself. So I'll qualify that with one thing. If somehow the people who are on the parachain, the 90% of people on the parachain who really wanted to, roll back or revert something, managed to persuade the governance or the people behind the governance structures of Polkadot as a whole, so basically like all of the parachains, in principle sort of economic might, they could force the entire system to do some kind of extraordinary change of validation function for that particular chain, but it would require the governance of the whole of Polkadot to agree on it. And assuming that assuming there's more than one parachain, which I hope, then that would be very difficult, because you'd have to go to the other people and say, well, this isn't really your stuff, but I need you to vote in the favor in this direction. And they would say, well, why would I vote in that direction for you if there's other people on your chain that actually want me to vote in the direction of something else? You'd have to take it to some sort of upper court, upper Supreme Court. Yep.
Yeah, so my question is, if I have a parachain, I join this network, do I get a stake in the governance of the Polkadot automatically, some degree? Or this is like a separate group of people that is controlling this relaying and the validation and so on? What's the stake of the parachain in this governance?
So the parachain governance itself.
Can you repeat the question?
Sure. So what's the who would be taking part in the parachain governance as or the relay chain governance? I presume that's yeah. So parachain governance in and of itself is nothing extraordinary. Parachains themselves, when they submit themselves for inclusion into the Polkadot community, would state, well, you know, this is our validation function. Perhaps there's some inherent token of the parachain that they denote as meaning governance or stakeholding token. They would be able to say, right, well, actually, this validation function, if it's got some supermajority, let's say 75% of our parachain token holders, if they actually state, well, actually, we want to vote in this, we will vote in this direction in order to make an extraordinary state transition, then that's fine. But it has to be set up in advance, right? It has to be part of the validation function. In terms of the overarching Polkadot system itself, the governance structure is, as I said earlier, it's not been fully specified, but basically the stakeholders would be denoted by a stakeholding token. So there would be some ability to succinctly determine which accounts own what part of what stake. Have access to what stakeholder, you know, can in some sense determine the direction of the system by virtue of this underlying accounting system. Now, that ideally would only be a fallback, in the same way that, you know, countries have referendums basically when the political leaders don't have the balls to actually do what needs to be done. So ideally, it wouldn't be needed most of the time because the governance mechanism would be sufficient to ensure that fallback is that whatever would happen on that fallback would be done as part of their decision making apparatus. Now the basic idea here is that it would probably be some form of bi or tricameral system whereby you've got some probably executive sort of branch, as it were, plus a technical advisory, plus plus the validators themselves. Yep.
Maybe I should have derived this from the talk, but two questions: like, is it possible for a relay chain to be a parachain in another model, or alternatively, would it be feasible? And I think this is maybe less likely for a parachain to be giving away sovereignty on finality.
Yeah, so a single parachain, no. Finality, because what would happen if they said this is final and actually the one said no, it's not. That said, it is in principle possible to have a bridged parachain with its own determination of finality be available to two different relay chains through two different bridge stubs. Possibly a more interesting model would be to have a standard parachain or even a full-on relay chain be bridged into another relay chain. So this wouldn't be an asymmetric model. So one would in principle be the relay chain of the other one, but in principle it doesn't actually need to be. It's probably, and I say probably because it's not fully thought through, but it's probably a more or less symmetric model, actually, in practical terms. So in terms of finality, I think we're sort of, the paper sort of suggests probably a 50 block finality, which we could probably say is maybe 5 seconds block time might be a reasonable target. So what does that work out as? 5, 12, 4 minutes, So that kind of time to allow a transaction to move along the bridge seems reasonable if you've got fairly robust proof of stake, proof of authority, BFT consensus mechanisms on both sides. It's certainly a very interesting direction to go in.
So for the moment, we plan to have a token sale, or token voucher sale early next year, and the idea would be that we would sell a token voucher on Ethereum, so ERC-20 standard. Then we have to finish a research and development phase on Polkadot, and then we'll kind of establish whether the token stays on Ethereum, or there's some better place for it, or for the governance structure. The most important thing for us in terms of the token is to be able to ensure that if users want to use the open source protocol to create portfolios or funds on other chains in future, that they have the ability to do that with the token wherever the home of the token is. Without kind of hurting the people who contributed towards the initial token pre-sale.
Mm-hmm. And how will you use Polkadot?
How do we use Polkadot? For us, this is really exciting because, I mean, my takeaway from Polkadot is that it's the first, it's a very secure way to transfer value across chains. And previously, if we wanted to host other assets of Ethereum inside our portfolios, we wouldn't be able to do that in a decentralized way or in a trustless way. So the first huge value add for us is that Polkadot enables us to hold and manage assets from any parachains that may connect to Polkadot in future. The second really interesting thing is that essentially we can, if you think about Melon as an idea, we can implement that idea on other chains in future and essentially direct essentially Melon tokens will have an inflation as well, but the new tokens will be paid to developers who build modules on Melon on top. So essentially if people want to build modules on other chains in future, that we can easily direct those incentives towards other chains.
Maybe we continue in like smaller.
Yeah,
I'm
sorry.
Cool. Thanks for coming by. There's still beer, and I think there's also a few bits of pizza there.